Hello everyone, and welcome to How to Cook Healthy Plant-Based Meals Without Oil with myself, Evita Ochel. Just to give you a quick summary, I am a holistic nutritionist as well as an optimal health and optimal nutrition educator and author. And it is really my passion and calling to help empower people like yourselves to make the best choices amidst what has become really a nutritional and health crisis of all kinds of proportions today when it comes to knowing how to feed ourselves right. My intention with creating this class and offering it is to raise awareness about the importance of this topic, because so many people are not aware, do not know, you know, why do I even need to consider plant-based eating perhaps, or what's so bad about oils? Why wouldn't I want to cook with them or have them in my diet? And so it's a big topic, but through this class, just to, you know, manage your expectations as well, I would like to cover first in part one, as much as possible for you to understand what is the problem with oils. This is not any kind of fad diet. This is not, sometimes people say, oh, you know, I've heard of clean eating. Is this some kind of, you know, extreme extension? Absolutely not. This is a matter of your highest state of health and prevention when it comes to the big problems in our society, when it comes to the top killers like heart disease, cancer, diabetes, when it comes to the obesity problems we have. And so whatever diets come and go, this stays, this is as it is. And this is why I feel it's so important, because it is nothing short of life-saving information. Part two, we're going to look at how to get more practical, since we want to minimize or avoid oils for optimal health reasons. Then how do we cook without them, given that our society is pretty much, you know, based on oils in terms of every meal, every recipe. Whatever processed food you pick up at the store today, they're pretty much guaranteed to be oils in it. Everything from pasta sauce to ice cream to pretty much you name it. So how do we then manage, at least inside of our own homes, where you have the most control over the food you eat? And so moving forward, as part of our introduction, the first place I want us to begin is to understand, what does this healthy plant-based mean? So again, we manage expectations, and all come from, you know, this same foundation, right? Because we're all coming from different backgrounds. But this way you will be aware of, okay, this is what she means by healthy plant-based eating at the very least, right? Because again, so many different teachers out there, so many different perspectives. And so is it vegan eating? Well, no, not quite. Take a look at the foods that we have here, from fruits, vegetables, grains, legumes. We've got nuts, seeds, oils, highly processed foods that includes all kinds, anything you can pretty much think of. Dairy, eggs, and meat. And so here, for a vegan diet, it would have everything except the animal foods. That means that when you hear studies or media reports about, well, vegan diet's been proven to be helpful here, but oh no, vegan eaters are not better off in this regard. This is why a vegan diet is no guarantee or not guaranteed to be optimally healthy. Yes, it will exclude animal products, but the quality of that diet depends on the person eating it. They could be focusing on whole plant foods or refined processed foods. And that makes all the difference to the health effects they're going to get. So we can't say, oh, yes, you know, vegan eating is healthy or unhealthy. It depends. Plant-based has become a popular term these days, especially given our health crisis, weight crisis, and environmental crisis. We've got a lot of challenges, but the good news is we can do something about it. And that's where these types of information and awareness raising sessions are concerned, for you to make the best choices that you can. So plant-based will have the same characteristics in these first groups of foods. Notice oils, highly processed foods are there. But when it comes to the animal products, it's a maybe. And the maybe is because a plant-based diet is not necessarily 100% plant-based. So a lot of people today say, well, I eat plant-based. All they mean is they eat a lot of plants. They put an emphasis on plants, maybe 75, 80%, 90% of their diet, but they still eat some animal products. So that's what that label would mean. And then healthy plant-based, like truly healthy plant-based, which comes down to optimally healthy plant-based, is a whole food plant-based diet. Notice the difference. Yes to all the whole plant foods. No to oils, because it's not a whole plant food. No to highly processed foods, because they're not whole plant foods. They use refined foods, synthetic ingredients, all kinds of things. And obviously, no to animal products. So when we hear and you know, most of the time on the media, we're not going to hear this, unfortunately, but if you branch out your, you know, learning, your interest, your awareness into the broader circles of information about health and nutrition and weight today and how to achieve the best in each of these areas, then you will find that whole food plant-based diet has been medically, scientifically proven to be able to heal so many of our chronic diseases, reverse heart disease. It's pretty much a given if you approach it in the right way, reversing things like diabetes or at least halting their progression. Now, that's big because so many people are suffering with these diseases, preventing these conditions to begin with, as well as even when it comes to cancer, decreasing the risk tremendously of many cancers, if not, I can boldly say most or all cancers. And also being able to actually treat them effectively without all, you know, so many of the other negative effects. So this is extremely powerful. And that's just for these chronic diseases. Weight, the most weight-friendly approach when it comes to infections, the best for your immune system, the best for your digestive system. And, you know, the list goes on and on. So when we're talking about what does it take for human beings to optimize their health through their diet, this is the approach that we can look at. These two, maybe, maybe not. It depends. With this one, we know exactly what we're eating. We know exactly what we're not eating. And we know the science behind it and why it works and is so powerful. So that's the foundation I wanted to set of where are we going in this class with what healthy plant-based eating means and why it doesn't include oils. So why are oils a problem? Well, for many of us, this is a huge shock, especially that in our society, we're taught to believe there are bad oils and good oils, right? So if you're eating the good oils, you're doing not only the right thing, but in many respects, we are taught to believe that we're doing a really heart healthy or a healthy thing for our body or our brain. And it's not like that, unfortunately. Oils are fats, but they're not the fats of your diet. So please don't think that by taking out oils, you're going to miss fats. Absolutely not. It's all about getting them from their whole foods before the oil was processed and refined. So first, as I've already mentioned to you, oils are not real food. They're an extract of the food. They're not a whole food. They're an isolated compound. They're basically just the fat of the olive. What happened to the fiber? What happened to the protein? What happened to all the vitamins and minerals? Same thing, whether we're talking about sunflower oil, the sunflowers, or sunflower seeds more specifically. What about coconuts? Again, it's an extract, fat only. What happened to all the other good stuff, right? So this is where they unnaturally isolate fat. Our body has no experience with an isolated fat compound. It doesn't exist naturally in nature, and our bodies only started to take in oils as our society processed, refined, created these products and said, look, now you should be using it, right? And that's what's also a lot, shocking, I find, for a lot of people is they can't imagine how to cook without oils. But for most of human history, we've been doing just fine. It's really just in the last 50 to 70 years that oils have become or made seem to be like a necessity that we can't cook without them. Nothing could be further from the truth. And ultimately, they are processed food. So refined or not refined, all oils are processed food. Next, humongous problem is all oils across the board cause inflammation, are inflammatory by their very nature. They also have problems with oxidation. Now, inflammation is the root cause of all chronic diseases and other symptoms and effects in the body. Oxidation is an even bigger problem in some cases because it also leads to free radical creation and, you know, creating or turning on cancer cells and increasing the risk of cancer. So that's a problem. Artery damage. All oils across the board. And I will talk more about that in just a moment. And really the problem is, you know, as soon as we ingest a meal high in oils or that contains, you know, a significant amount of oils, you know, just a simple tablespoon on a salad, what happens to our blood is it starts to slow and thicken. And that is not ideal for our body. Every single process in your body then starts to work differently. It's too bad we don't hear this kind of information on the 6 o'clock news or in the latest men's health or women's health magazine when they're trying to promote this oil or that oil. And of course, as the arteries weaken or get damaged by that very nature, cholesterol buildup begins because cholesterol is a protective mechanism of how our arteries try to repair themselves. So yes, there's cholesterols we could be taking in from our diet, Oils are not a source of cholesterol because they come from plants. Plants don't have cholesterol, but they can lead to cholesterol buildup as the body suffers damage and then tries to heal and repair itself, which obviously the buildup of cholesterol then leads to heart disease problems. So, weight problems. Oil is the most calorie-dense food with the least nutritional value. One tablespoon, roughly, is about 120 calories of pure fat. You're not getting pretty much nothing else except pure fat. And so one tablespoon, when you think about it, how liberal a lot of people are on specifically their salads, they add that one tablespoon, boom, the calorie value of that salad just went up by about 120 calories. Maybe in one day, not that big of a deal. But think about this over a week span, over a year span, how many extra calories? So I see people struggling in our society so much with weight loss, trying this diet, that diet. Meanwhile, almost all people overlook the presence of oils in their diet. And so oil is really the easiest way to gain weight, hardest weight loss to achieve, as long as the inflammation levels are high in the body. Body protects itself. Fat is a protective barrier as well. And of course, the extra fat, extra calories add up very quickly. And so obesity is a problem. Chronic diseases, we've already mentioned the heart disease, diabetes, cancer, all of these risks are increased. And digestive stress. A lot of us today suffering from all kinds of digestive troubles, bloating and indigestion and discomfort and pain. And often we can't kind of, you know, find the culprit. We say, oh, maybe it's IBS, maybe it's colitis, maybe it's this, that. But one of the first things to notice is that oils tend to really impede digestion. And so if you eat the same meal, whatever you eat, but no oils added to it or in it, you may find your digestion immediately improved. And so do keep that in mind if you're really suffering with a lot of digestive issues. But other than that, just a meal high or heavy in oils, anything fried, anything that has added oils to it, whether cooked or not cooked, usually leaves us heavier, lower in energy because it's so difficult to digest oils. Again, they're unnatural to the human body. It's not an easy fat, which fat already is a little harder to digest, like that, you know, if I ate a real nut or a real seed. And so some digestive distress is common. So a quick show here. This is a chart of the summary of oil studies and results just for you to be aware of. And for those of you who like the more the academic, the science side of things, then you could look at the source and find this online, Is Oil Healthy? This is a report in the International Journal of Disease Reversal and Prevention. And it is Dr. Caldwell Esselstyn here has put together basically what studies have been done that are quality studies and what they have shown, whether the fat is monounsaturated, polyunsaturated, or saturated, whether the oil is olive oil or another oil like palm oil, which is a saturated oil. In all cases, the results have pointed to the risks that we have just talked about. When you see something like I want to bring your attention to here, flow-mediated dilation, this is, again, what happens to arteries right after the meal with oil. They can measure this. They can clearly see what happens to a person's arteries right after a meal with oil and how that artery changes, how the lining of the arteries are impacted, and how the blood changes and the flow, you know, thickens and slows, etc. So again, it's no surprise about, you know, atherosclerosis and things like obesity, diabetes, etc. So these are, again, the studies that we would hope would come out to the general public, but they don't. Instead, what we get are studies telling us, oh, look, coconut oil is good for this, or olive oil is good for this. And specifically, I want to highlight olive oil because while, again, many of you joining me today might be already well aware that there's so many bad oils, like you wouldn't want vegetable oil, corn oil, you know, sunflower oil, even cotton oil and things like that. But most of us think that by eating olive oil, it's a heart healthy oil. We're doing a good thing for ourselves. So this is where you have to be aware that when you're hearing these types of reports out in the media, popular magazines, etc., they are almost always comparative studies or studies basically done in a way to show the effect that they want to show. What's a comparative study? The simple example, let's do a study comparing olive oil with butter. Participants who eat olive oil, how does this impact their heart? And participants who eat butter, how does this impact their heart? Well, the participants with olive oil do better, have less risks, or better heart health. So all of a sudden, the study comes out and the media picks it up and says, olive oil found to be heart healthy. Just because butter was worse doesn't mean that olive oil is a good idea. It was just less bad for the heart compared to the butter. So this is something you have to be careful of. Be aware of as a conscious, discerning consumer today. Comparing something bad to something worse does not make it good. And this is how most oil studies in our society are done. So I get it. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, especially when all of us at some point in our lives learn about something we've been eating, thinking, oh, we're doing ourselves so good, just to find out we weren't. I've been there on numerous accounts on my own personal journey as my professional journey in the field of health and nutrition continued. I get it. We feel sad. We feel sometimes, you know, really upset even because we feel we've been led down the wrong path. But we can also look at it from a positive perspective. We don't know what we don't know until we know. Our society, you know, is doing the best that it can in many places. And sometimes the best doctors don't know any better. So it's not about laying blame and it's not about beating ourselves up. It's about stopping, standing, focusing on this moment right now and saying, okay, this is what I did in the past. But now that I know this, what am I going to do about it? That's the power. So the past was the past. Just focus on what do you choose from now on? Now that you know what is best for your health, what are your own health priorities? These are the questions you need to ask yourself to be, you know, in alignment with and move through your own personal health and nutrition journey in as peaceful way as possible. Don't have a stressful journey with your food. Otherwise, this creates just more disease, more problems, and just more suffering unnecessarily. So it's very important here to, again, just take a moment, take that deep breath and say, okay, all right, so this is what was, this is what is, now what do I choose? And what you choose is, again, up to you, depending on what your health priorities are. So how then can you reduce your risk? Well, it all depends, as I've just shared, what you're ready for. But ultimately, extreme health risk is in this, high oil use. So if you are here, the next best step is to move yourself to the middle area. And if you're in the middle area, hopefully to the next area to the right, you see? So you don't have to do it all at once. Don't get overwhelmed. No need to get stressed. Just one step, one meal, one food at a time. Easy does it. This is how you get sustainable results, effective results in your life and your dietary lifestyle, and not feel overwhelmed, stressed, and do that bandwagon kind of crash, like, oh, I'm all over this. I love this. I need to do this. And then you fizzle out and burn out because it was too much too soon. So slow and steady. So if you are in the high oil use area, that means you use some or a lot of different refined oils, fried oils, heavily cooked oils. You're maybe using these at home or going out to eat a lot, where high temperatures are used, the food is cooked for a long time, and large amounts of oils. So this is the most extreme health risk. This is where we have the highest risk of all the chronic diseases, all the weight problems, highest inflammation, etc. Moderate health risk, this is where you lower your health risk, but still are not in that ideal range yet, is if you are using oils in a very low, minimal, sporadic way, and are also focused on unrefined oils only, raw oils. That means if you are using them, you're not cooking with them, you're adding them to the meal, either in its raw form or after it's been cooked. If you are cooking, it's for very short periods of time and very low temperature and very small amounts of oils. So no tablespoon of oil on your salad, maybe a teaspoon, if for whatever reason you feel you still want it or need it. And the optimal path, and again, this is for optimal health and well-being, is the no oil use. And is this possible? Yes. Is it realistic? Yes. However, little asterisk, if you eat any processed food, then avoiding all oils is next to impossible. Okay. If you eat any restaurant food, then avoiding all oils is next to impossible. It's possible, but it's rare and it's not easy. Okay. So you have to keep that in mind. But if you eat only whole plant foods that you make in your own home, or even if they're not all whole plant foods, but you do create them and cook them in a way that doesn't involve oils, completely realistic and easy to do. So here again, I do encourage always that we don't take an extremist approach and say, I never could have an even drop of oil in my life. It's going to kill me. Absolutely no, don't take an extremist approach. It's not good for your health, seriously. So you want to do the best that you can. Increase the area where you absolutely don't have to, don't need to, and don't want to use oils. But if you happen to be out with friends, the one time or the odd time where you can't avoid the use of oils in a meal, excuse me, Or perhaps you're out on the go, you weren't able to make your own hummus without oils. This is a very common and big example for many people who eat plant-based. And you have to buy that store-made, store-bought hummus, which will always have some oil pretty much in it. Then again, this is where mitigate your risks, that it's a very low risk in that case versus, you know, eating a fast food meal or eating oil-based cooked meal. So again, mitigate your risks. Think, you know, holistically as possible. So you don't, again, get into a stressful situation, beat yourself up and become too extreme, too rigid, which I see always bounces out and people completely abandon good, healthy eating altogether. So when you don't use oils, what do you use to cook with specifically? In most cases, just water. Water works wonders. Other liquids, we'll talk about those, or no liquids whatsoever. And you just cook in a dry fashion. So again, lots of choices, lots of options. You step in where you're ready and address it as needed. But ultimately, to finalize this first part of raising awareness about why oils are a problem, the culminating point that I want to leave you with is there's an additional health risk on top of just eating oil in its raw, unrefined form, uncooked, etc., is when you heat the oil. In our society, we hear today, you know, oh, well, the smoke point of this oil is good, or use this one for cooking. This one's safe. This one's good. Ultimately, no oil is safe to cook with. Yes, saturated fats, such as the coconut oil you see here in this image, yes, they are much more heat stable, extremely heat stable compared to unsaturated oils, such as mono and poly, whether it's olive oil, canola oil, sunflower oil, etc. But still only up to a point, still only up to a point. So if somebody says, oh yes, I've got a green light here to fry my foods as long as I use coconut oil, absolutely not, okay? It's still only up to a point. And we have to remember that coconut oil is a saturated fat, and isolated saturated fats in this form are tied to being a higher risk for heart disease and other problems. So this is where, please don't fall for the smoke point. Nowadays, I see, about 10 years ago or so, it was grapeseed oil that was touted as the cooking oil to use that's safe. Nowadays, I find it's avocado oil. People are going on the avocado oil bandwagon. Oh, this is the healthy and safe one too. In truth, again, no oils are safe to heat with, because way before the smoke point, there's damage happening. Plus, let's not forget all the other problems that oils have, regardless if they're heated or not. So this is where we have to take a, an honest approach. And again, find where and how you want to mitigate your own risk factors. So now the practical component. How then do we cook without oils? Especially that, again, our society has trained us to think that there's no way, or life without oils is just impossible. Well, not only is it possible, but it's so much better. I have to tell you that on my own personal journey, because we are so heavily conditioned to believe that oils are necessary and essential and even a good thing in some cases, right? Like that healthy heart, healthy olive oil, we have a really hard time, you know, wrapping our head around, wait, so I stop using it and then I don't even cook with, like, what do I do, right? So for many people, myself included, it is easier, you know, to, for example, give up things like, let's say, meat or dairy rather than oils, because the others have these black and white, you know, this is a problem, health problem, environmental problem, animal welfare problem. But oils, well, they're plants. Sustainability doesn't seem to be an issue unless, you know, we're talking about palm oil, right? And everybody seems to be doing it. And some even we are told are good for us, right? So it's much harder to wrap our heads around and really allow ourselves the journey step by step to release oils out of our life, out of our diets as much as possible. So to begin with here on this note, optimally healthy eating, therefore, is not just about the foods we choose, but what we choose to do with those foods. That's very, very important. This means that if you want a three-step process of how to approach this and make it effective, step one is change the mind. Step two, change the food. And step three, change the cooking. Let's go back though to the mind. This is what I just finished talking about, and this is what I keep mentioning to you throughout our class today. If you don't take the time to decondition yourself from everything you've been led to believe, this is not going to work if you, you know, choose to go oil-free or if you choose to go plant-based in any manner. It's not going to work unless you first prepare the mind, unless you first, again, decondition and change your mind. because if somebody is in a resistant state or has really deeply held beliefs and habits and thinking patterns, and they say, but okay, I know I've heard this is good for, you know, heart health, heart disease runs in my family, I'm going to do it. Okay, so now you've changed the food, maybe you've changed the cooking method, but if you haven't prepped the mind, this change is not going to last. And this is why, again, some people find themselves on those, you know, wagons, or I'm on, I'm off, you know, etc. It's just, it's tiresome. It wastes your energy and it wastes your resources. So if you want effective change in your life, by the way, this doesn't just go for your food and diet, change and prepare the mind first. Once you know what you're going to do and why you're going to do it and why whatever was in the past should no longer be part of the present, then you are ready for effective change in your life. So in this regard, change the food. If you want to continue eating fish and I tell you to cook with water and you say to yourself, well, how do I do that? That's not going to taste very well when I'm used to fried fish. This is not about learning how to cook fried fish without oil, right? It's just not going to work. Fried fish is fried fish because it uses oil and high extreme heavy cooking methods. So if you're used to that, if you love that, if you crave that, that's how the package that it comes in, and that's why it has the risks that it has for health and, you know, your weight, etc. So this is where the more that you can change and increase whole plant foods in your diet, the easier the cooking also becomes. And one other thing I wanted to mention to you is when you change to oil-free cooking, your kitchen will become so much cleaner in the sense that your food prep and washing just dishes is so easy. Nothing is oily. Nothing is oily. Nothing leaves that greasy residue anywhere. You don't have to deal with, you know, throwing away any oils or anything like that. It's just remarkable. You also save money. You don't have to buy, you know, the oils of any kind. And especially when we're talking about olive oil, I want to mention another practical tip here for you. A lot of people say, okay, yeah, olive oil, great, great. You know, I hear it's good, etc. But they just pick the cheapest olive oil at the store, which is usually either they use other oils in it, or it's you know, fabricated in a way to make it the cheapest, you know, worst quality possible. If you know your olive oil, then a really good olive oil is supposed to be slightly bitter, and it's, you know, it's like $30 per liter, not $5 to $10 per liter. So if you were even going to use them, you should be using the highest, purest quality, but ultimately you could save yourself money altogether and again, avoid them. So changing the mind, changing the food helps us to get ready for changing the cooking method. And this is where the four main cooking methods that I want to make you aware of and help steer you in this direction when you're thinking of, well, how then do I cook these, you know, plant-based meals and make them optimally healthy? Well, the first is the easiest. If you're going to eat something like fruits or a salad, you don't need to do any cooking and you definitely don't need any oils. So to keep in mind that part of optimally healthy eating, we do want to keep a good portion. And I'm going to go out and say even a high portion of our foods in its raw form. And yes, I've heard over the years so much that people can't digest raw foods, but that's not because you can't digest raw foods. It's because the reliance of your past diet on heavily heated, cooked, processed food has disabled your body from being able to optimally digest the most natural foods for it. But good news, all is not lost. You can heal your body back to be able to digest raw foods. So if you're dealing with a lot of cramping, bloating, if you have, you know, some raw vegetables, the good news is this doesn't have to be a permanent state. And so as we heal the body, as we remove so much of the synthetic processed and heavily heat treated and fried food, then our bodies know what to do and automatically gravitate towards raw food. So what kind of foods here are we talking about? Well, fruits, by their very nature, should be raw. No need to cook them. And we don't want to cook them to maintain their optimal nutritional and health benefits. Vegetables, specifically non-starchy. So this is all your leafy greens, your lettuces, etc. Anything like celery, anything, for example, that is watery, like a cucumber, you wouldn't want to. These are non-starchy vegetables. You don't want to be cooking these to begin with. Sprouted plant foods do not need to be cooked. This is your sprouts. The whole point of sprouting them is to make them alive, and you don't want to be killing them by actually subjecting them to heat. So some people like to sprout their nuts or seeds and eat them raw in that way. Absolutely. Some even do that to some safe legumes, such as lentils or mung beans. And some people even like to sprout their grains. And again, good grains for this are something like quinoa. Buckwheat can be easily eaten raw just by soaking it overnight. So there's some options here that we don't even have to cook. You can save time, save money, and optimize your health and digestion as well. And by the way, if you're on a weight loss journey, raw foods, the very same amount, the very same food in its raw form will give you less calories than the very same amount, the very same food in its cooked form. So it's another positive weight loss tip. And nuts and seeds in the raw form, not roasted, not, again, fabricated, processed in any way. Next, the next cooking method that works brilliantly for pretty much most whole plant foods that need it are the steam or saute methods. Now, when I refer to steam or saute, I'm going to explain it because I'm not referring to what most of us may already be thinking. When people think of steaming, they think, okay, I put water in a pot, then put my steamer, maybe pot on, right? And get that steam to penetrate through. Yes, you can do that. That's fantastic. That's how you can, for example, defrost or cook in the healthiest way. Something like frozen vegetables, frozen peas. You can steam your fresh cauliflower, fresh broccoli. This does wonders for that. Yes, that's possible. I'm going to go to saute before I come back to the steam. Sauté is not where you pour some oil and shake things around almost like a stir fry, okay? Sometimes it's looked at that way, or again, we have this notion that oil is required to sauté. No. So what I combine as a steam and sauté, and I talk about this and I show this in great detail in the my Cook Real Food course, is to use the one pot or one pan cooking method where you get a skillet, okay, a pan, and you place a very thin layer of water on it, just enough to cover the base comfortably. Then you would put your food, in this case, it could be your vegetables, your fresh legumes or mushrooms, close the lid, and on about medium heat or slightly lower, not high heat, we want to be, again, smart also with how we use our heat to not ruin or degrade more of the nutritional value from our food. You would allow the steam to naturally build up in there and perfectly soften the food. And you can make a sauce out of that by adding in some herbs, some spices, some other liquids, and it cooks things perfectly, deliciously with no sticking. And we'll talk more about that in just a moment. So pan, thin layer of water, lid on, about 5 to 10 minutes is all you need. 5 to 10 minutes in this method for all of these. Your vegetables, that includes your starchy and non-starchy. So whether you want to do some chopped up finely sweet potatoes or some bell peppers, yes, this method works brilliantly. No oils needed. Fresh legumes, this could be, again, your peas, your snow peas, maybe some fresh string beans, etc. And mushrooms, sliced mushrooms of any kind that you may like. So this is extremely easy cooking method. It's an extremely healthy cooking method. And again, no foods are left oily. There's no risks associated with oil, etc. And it's extremely weight friendly as well for these types of foods. Now, another common method is, of course, boiling. And boiling is the best method to use and a necessary method to use when it comes specifically to dry grains and dry legumes. The point being that when you buy dry grains, whether it's quinoa, whether it's buckwheat, whether it's sorghum, millet, etc., and dry legumes, whichever ones you like, from lentils to your kidney beans to your pinto beans, you name it. This is the way that we would cook them, by first soaking them overnight and then boiling them in water. And really, boiling means just bring them to a boil and then let them simmer for the appropriate amount of time. But you can also do some boiling with starchy vegetables. And again, bring the water to a boil and then lower it down to about medium. So it's more of a simmer. And starchy vegetables that I'm specifically referring to here would be like your potatoes, your yams, butternut and buttercup, and all the kinds of squashes do really well with this method. But again, anytime we want to, also for as a smart cooking and optimal health and nutrition tip, we want to use the least water possible. So with grains, legumes, we don't mind. We can't use less water than the exact amounts pretty much that we need. With potatoes, I always say, you know, put the minimum possible to cover basically the potatoes, but not like a huge pot of water. But ultimately, the less water you use. So this is why I love that one pan cooking method on that thin layer of water, just right to generate some steam, beautifully cooks the food easily and quickly without using a lot of water, where some of the vitamins or minerals can actually leach out and we lose them unless we're eating a soup. So this would also, boiling, simmering is also the way we would cook our soups. Finally, dry roasting. Instead of all the oily roasted kind of things, dry roasting is the way to go if you want to make, for example, some healthy sweet potato French fries. Okay, so notice I call them French fries, but they really aren't. They're not fried. They're not using any kind of, you know, processed potatoes. They're not browning. Browning is a problematic reaction that happens with high starch foods that we want to avoid as much as possible, as they create acrylamides. And if you're new to this, please look it up on your own, because that if you're eating a lot of these foods, they could be causing a huge health, also inflammation and cancer risk. So we want to keep our roasting in a dry form and in a way that reduces discoloration as much as possible. So some people like to put the, you know, a tray of sweet potatoes or beets or yams of some kind, or squash is great for this, portobello mushrooms, just in their toaster oven or in their oven dry like this and not covered, because they like a little bit of the dry buildup without discoloration, while others will cover it with aluminum foil so that there's a natural buildup of steam while they are baking or cooking in this way. So there's a few options in how you would like your food to turn out. But ultimately, this method is best and only recommended for starchy vegetables and mushrooms that are better at handling high heat. Okay, so again, be mindful too of sensitive vegetables. This is why, you know, I know sometimes people like to cook their spinach, but it always pains me because spinach is such a sensitive vegetable. And to cook it, you see it, it goes limp. It nutritionally is, you know, degraded in many regards. So also when you're working with your food, assess its sensitivity, its vulnerability, right? Some automatically tell us like, no, I'm very fragile. Keep me as, you know, raw, as unadulterated as possible. While others are very tough, right? Dry beans, dry grains, a lot of these starchy vegetables, they tell us you need to soften me to enjoy me properly. So that's where you've got a lot of options here in how you approach this for, again, best health and weight results. Now, I know some of you are thinking, what about the cookware? This is super important on this journey as well. So if you're not using oils, the first thought may be, oh my goodness, well, for sure, I'm going to have to use nonstick cookware. Well, the unfortunate part is most people in North America, and now it's spread to so many other parts of the world, are using nonstick cookware all the time and unnecessarily for the most part. So this is the first thing I'd like to raise your, you know, attention to and raise awareness about, because nonstick cookware has a lot of its own health risks, regardless what you're eating and how you're eating it. So you have to be aware of that first. And nonstick cookware was marketed, and again, people became conditioned to use it without thinking twice that if you're using or choosing something like a stainless steel pot, then food will stick. Not true. Okay, so if you use the water methods that I just talked about, grains don't stick to their pot unless you don't put a timer and overcook. So you might be thinking, see, exactly, I'm going to get food to stick. Well, the solution is very easy. Don't put your health at risk by using a high toxin, high chemical cookware like nonstick. Simply use a timer. And, you know, before we used to have to use our stove or oven timers. Now everybody's pretty much got a cell phone in within arm's reach. Just set the timer. If you set the timer and cook in the right amount of water, you absolutely get perfect results all the time. You can't ruin your beans or your grains or your vegetables. You just have to set your timers. Be mindful of that and make sure there's enough moisture or water in the pot. Nothing will stick. Even if something does stick because you slightly maybe used a little less water than you thought, walked away, your child got your attention, you come back and some of those bell peppers, mushrooms that you were, you know, sauteing in that little, you know, bit of water dried out, especially if you have a gas stove rather than a electric. Gas is much more, powerful in the regard that heat is not as easy to control. No problem. If you just put some water after you remove the food, or sometimes it even comes off itself during the cooking if you add more water. But after you remove the food, add some water to the pot, let it sit for an hour, the food comes right off. So I basically am sharing this with you because I want to break the fear of people using stainless steel. It's so much healthier for you. And it's so much easier than we've been led to believe. And in 9 out of 10 cases, you don't need nonstick. And what's more interesting is I see people use nonstick and oils on top of that, thinking, you know, oh, if I don't, it's going to stick. Again, it's overkill, and it's every single one of those actions increases your health risks tremendously. So for most cases, stainless steel, best for most of your cooking, you can get away with it. And by the way, my personal preference and some thing I always recommend is, if possible, if you're buying a new set, always go for glass lids, because it makes the cooking that much more successful, that much more easy, not to mention enjoyable, as you see what's happening along every step of the way. Glass, if you like glass, absolutely, that's wonderful. And in some cases, it's needed, especially if you're doing something like a veggie lasagna with a non-dairy cheese. You can put that in the oven. And of course, you're usually going to be needing one of those glass containers. Also, glass can be used on the stovetop. Sometimes there's glass pots. They're heavier. They're a little bit harder, you know, not as practical to work with. But if you like it, glass is safe and healthy option. Cast iron is great, and you can get away without using any oils, especially for other foods that maybe we didn't mention. With cast iron, if it's seasoned right, I don't personally recommend much cast iron, because most people buy the cheap one and don't season or don't maintain it properly, in which case the food starts to stick and it becomes a health risk in other ways too. So if you buy a good quality cast iron pan, you know how to season it, you know how to cook with it, it has to be the right heat, then you can have great results with that. It's just, again, more cumbersome, and I find not practical for most people's needs. So if you like it, it's possible, but not optimal. And again, nonstick is the worst. This should be used really for rare cooking. And what do I mean by rare cooking is, if you look at these three examples, this type of pan or skillet is what I absolutely recommend as the go-to to have. If you're a 1 to 2 person family, about 10, 12 inches will do. If you're a big person family, you need, like, if you've got, you know, 3, 4, 5 people or more, you need one that is thicker and maybe a little bit wider, 12 to 14 inches with a lid. You can cook, like I said, most of your plant-based foods in this alone. And here's the steaming sauteing process of eggplant on just a thin layer of water with a lid. And if you notice in the background, to be made into a homemade baba ganoush, which is an eggplant spread without any oils. And I'll talk more about that in just a moment. This is the pot method, small or large 5-quart pot that you would be using to cook your beans, to cook your grains. This would be the way to do it, or for example, to boil your potatoes. So you see, nonstick not needed in any of these cases. Where nonstick is needed, and this is the only way, the place that you know, those rare cases, is if you like to make your own veggie burgers, veggie patties, bean patties, whatever. They can be made out of grains, out of beans, out of vegetables, out of mushrooms. Delicious and so easy to make and so satisfying. But this is the only place that you can't use a stainless steel pan or a glass pan. And in this case, though, you can still reduce your risk by buying the safest possible nonstick. And there's better options today that are trying to use ceramic, definitely not Teflon, or, you know, products like it. So many options. And as you can see, this makes cooking easy and versatile. Let's flip the cooking now to look at the meal specifically. Salads don't need any cooking, except, of course, the beans that you would want to add to them. And this is where no oil is needed to be added, even in its raw form. The best salads are based on lemon or lime juice, freshly squeezed. Increases the iron value for women who are concerned about iron. Absolutely one of the best ways to increase your iron naturally and extract it out of your legumes and out of your leafy greens. It also increases the beautiful flavors of all the different vegetables and beans, and it also blends other flavors really well. So refreshing, wonderful health benefits all along, all around, by using just lemon lime juice. You like balsamic vinegar? Fantastic. Apple cider vinegar? Fantastic. You can use that. But people say sometimes, you know, but, oh, that just doesn't make the salad taste good. Well, of course not. You don't just want to use one of these. You want to use that kind of a liquid plus herbs and spices. And I have a whole video template on how to make the best whole meal salads. And you can find that, as I'll share, on one of my websites. So herbs and spices, fresh or dried, absolutely amazing. And for those times, or those of you who really enjoy a creamy dressing, forget the oil-based ranch and all the processed stuff. You can make your own delicious, easy, creamy nut or seed sauces. And I also have a video template available online about that. Soups. Soups is where we get into cooking. So here we're thinking, okay, what do I do? How do I cook this without oil? Very easy. No soup ever needs oil. It's unfortunate that in most cases, especially in restaurant settings, if you're eating something like a chili or a soup, they automatically add oil to it for no good reason whatsoever. It's really, you know, to... for in most cases to make the meal feel almost like richer, but it only ends up making, you know, sometimes a very oily meal. So that's not a very pleasant thing. Soups do not need any oils. Water, herbs and spices, tomato puree. I'm talking about the bottle here, not the can, not a tomato sauce, the pure tomato puree, nothing else in it. Coconut milk, organic, without the preservatives, additives in a can. Also makes a great base for all kinds of soups, whether they're creamy or more like a curry. Blended nuts and seeds can also make a delicious creamy butternut squash soup. You can have, again, all kinds of wonderful benefits and effects here without adding any oil. So if you want that fattier, richer, maybe for the winter, you can easily achieve that with any of these methods. And I mean specifically for the fatter, richer coconut or nuts or seeds. And last but not least, although most soups won't need lime or lemon juice, unlike salads, if you're making a beet soup, the essence of beets comes out best with something like lemons or limes. And so this is where you would actually want to add the lemon lime, but to the end, not during the cooking, so it retains as much nutritional value as possible. Star meals, I have an entire video template on that, teaching you how to compose a wonderful, healthy plant-based meal that requires no oil to cook whatsoever. And I call them star meals because they're rich in the healthy starches and they are superstars, nutritionally speaking, and for our health and weight. So here again, you'd be using something like lemon lime juice, herbs and spices, tomato puree, coconut milk, or creamy nut or seed sauces. Some could be during the cooking process and some would be added after, as you see here on a beautiful, so it's potatoes, carrots, kale here with a creamy cashew garlic sauce. And what you would be doing there, again, boil your potatoes, one pan method of that delicate steam for the carrots. Kale comes in at the very last second just for a little bit of heat, and then you place that on your plate, pour it over with your favorite, you know, creamy sauce, and you've got an amazing meal without any oil and without any health problems. And then dry roasting, again, if you like to have something like that, then either you dry roast completely, no additions, or you could add some balsamic vinegar, just baste it, or sometimes, you know, you could pour it into the cap of a portobello mushroom. It cooks up really nice. Maple syrup in some cases. Again, you don't want to get used to making a lot of sugary excuse me, foods, but in some cases, some people like that, you know, glazed maple syrup effect, and ultimately herbs and spices. And so here's a few pictures to finish off our class. Here's an example of a wholemeal salad where the lentils didn't get mixed in, just to show you a different effect. And of course, in most cases, the lentils or the bean would just be mixed in. Notice that, you know, it doesn't look like a perfect salad, because in truth, that's exactly what the effect you're going to get. When you mix something creamy, naturally creamy like an avocado, something watery rich that releases its own juices like a tomato, when you mix this all together with some herbs, spices, lemon or lime juice, it automatically makes its own kind of, you know, dressing or moisture rich content. You don't need to add anything on top of this. It's amazing as it is on its own and amazingly tasting. As I talked to you about chilies and soups, no oils needed whatsoever. You would use a tomato-based puree, cook your beans, add in your vegetables, etc. Delicious meal right there. There's another example of a star meal with those starches and other additions. Here is a meal that is a coconut curry example, and you can use any grain from buckwheat to brown rice, and that coconut milk with herbs and spices makes a wonderful addition. No oils needed whatsoever to steam, saute, or cook any of these ingredients. Pasta dishes with or without sauces. Again, you can use the same method that you would apply to a salad, and it combines into a nice moisture rich. So it's not a dry meal. It's not a bland meal. It's delicious. It's wonderful for your palate in every way. And here's an example of a very different meal. Again, if you like the dry roasting, there's some butternut squash just placed down. So it, you know, the part that would brown is the part you would take off. And then you've got wonderfully soft and beautiful sweet butternut squash, some steamed, again, that one pan steamed green beans. You've got some tempeh, organic tempeh, a whole plant food, also dry cooked on a pan. And you can add in your own additions, such as a cilantro sauce, such as a homemade apple cranberry sauce. So nothing is dry, nothing is bland. You can enrich it with healthy fats like avocados, nuts and seeds, anytime you need. And so on that note, one final quick tip here. I mentioned to you baba ganoush, hummus, all kinds of nut, legume, but also nut and seed sauces today that are store-made. They're putting oils in them. And any recipes I see online typically have oils added. You don't need anything like that. So no oils are needed. When you're making these ingredients, you're using tahini, which is a sesame seed paste or a sesame seed butter, whole plant food. That is all the fat you need and provides all the rich creaminess you need. So oil, completely not needed. Crepes, pancakes, flatbreads. This is an example of homemade flatbreads. Whole grain flour, water alone, nothing more needed. No oil whatsoever to make any of these foods. So there's lots of different recipes like that. Baked goods, a lot of people simply swap out oil for applesauce, and it works wonders and makes a wonderful, rich and moist baked good if you're into making anything like that. Veggie burgers, same thing, no oils needed, just the legume, whatever else you're adding with it. And tofu scramble, same thing. The tofu itself usually has moisture in it. As you start to scramble it to make it into a tofu scramble, that's all the moisture it needs, no oil needed. So that's just a few common healthy plant-based meal examples to show you again that really whatever you can think of, no oil is needed. But to assess and to be successful with this, remember that three-step process. Change the mind, change the food, and change the approach to cooking. As you start to embrace that step by step, it all comes together and you're eating whole food, real food, the healthiest food for your weight and for your health, and you're feeling good about it and your health results show it. Further resources I mentioned to you, I have an over 7-hour cooking class online, and that's Cook Real Food. You can find that on my website under classes. On my website, other website, evolvingwellness.com, where I share written articles, recipes, you will find an article, Why Oils Are Not Part of a Whole Food Plant-Based Diet, that explains more or in other ways what I shared with you in part one. And there's also all oil-free recipes on that website. And forks over knives, I recommend them because they are also excellent at promoting optimally healthy eating habits. And they have some excellent articles about olive oil and coconut oil that you can find on their website. And so thank you so much, everyone, for joining me for this class. Hopefully you have, again, benefited in the way that is best for you at this time in your life. Remember, slow and steady, step by step. Take what resonates and make the changes that are most effective and something that you are most called to at this time. Thank you for joining me, and perhaps I will see you in another class.